And welcome back to another Paradox Interactive game series, this time with the game Europa Universalis IV. I'm Obsidian Spectre, and this game is their absolute flagship game, and that's no doubt about it. For those of you who follow my Hearts of Iron series, you know that I mentioned Hearts of Iron IV and Europa Universalis IV as their only really completed games now with all the DLCs. Many complain about this, that they release a lot of DLCs years to come to even complete the game, but these games require that, and I will defend Paradox Interactive altogether. The games are super complexive, and they need this to be perfected. The developers, they do this with their heart and soul. They love their stuff. This is not just corporate shit that is being thrown out. They love what they're doing. And you come up with new stuff over time as you see the community play, and they listen to their community. So this is their flagship game, absolutely. And compared to those of you who are used to my Hearts of Iron series, this is more sandboxy, a little bit more free. You can play. There are no factions that are set in stone here. You can create your own alliances, and every game is completely different than the other. And I really love this about this game as well, that you it's like playing a different game even if you restart a campaign with the same country. So I love that. And this is played out in the Renaissance era and the colonial era. So it stretches from 1444 to 1835. So between Crusader Kings and the Victorian era. And that's about it. Let's start it up here. So this game is about... You need to take yourself from the Dark Ages. You start with a feudal system still from the medieval times. And you need to follow up with technology to even be able to compete with the other nations everywhere. And that's what it's all about. And you can focus on administration, diplomacy, military, what you're the most good at. You can see different kind of players really are super good maybe in purely administration, diplomacy, or military, or a combination of them all, not specializing in any of them. I feel like I am a diplomatic kind of player. Diplomacy is my main thing here. The second one has to be administration, and military is the one I need to get better at. I don't think I really suck at it, but compared to most players I do, I don't know. But I don't feel secure in that. And we're going to get better at it this time, in this series. And we're going to play as Sweden. We're playing with the 1.34 Sweden patch and the Lions of the North DLC. So it's very fitting to play my own home country. And yes, I will see you in the game. Here we go. So, yeah. Sweden it is. And you saw in the beginning there that I had all the DLCs as well. We're running with everything. And I can read. I copied the text here. We need to read that. I chose Rise of the Ottomans. That's the common start of the game, 1444. So, rumors of Ottoman weakness caused Pope Eugene IV to call for a crusade against them in 1443. With the West still embroiled in the Hundred Years' War, the King of Hungary and Poland, Vladislav III, took on the cause to finally expel the scourge of Christendom from Europe. Led by General John Hunyadi, the White Knight, the Hungarian army saw some initial success, but was ultimately defeated. The abdicated Sultan Murad II came back to aid his son and led the Ottoman army to victory at the Battle of Varna, where King Vladislav was killed. Peace was eventually signed, but the way for further Ottoman expansion into Eastern Europe now lay open. So that says it all. The Ottoman Empire, they are very, very dangerous in this time. This is the rise of them, just as the campaign is called. And when it, yeah, in history, when then when they reach the Victorian era, they are more then they are called the sick man of Europe. They are, have been so much more weakened, and I'm not sure exactly what happened there, but that's the way it is. So we need really need to be scared of them here, or respect them, keep them at bay. We don't want the Ottomans to christen, to take away Christendom for all of Europe. So this is the religious map mode. So Catholics, that is what we are. And we have the Orthodox Christendom here, and we have the green area, which is the Muslims, Sunni, and a little part is Shia here. And we have a lot of other religions as well everywhere. And you cannot, you have not explored the map fully in the beginning in this game. It's a global map. Sooner or later, you can reach the Americas and everything, just like in Hearts of Iron. It just needs to be explored, because you're colonizing Africa, you're colonizing everything in America. We will not do it. We will not focus on that whatsoever. And we have the Holy Roman Empire here. They are strongest in the Crusader Kings era. So in this game, they are starting to weaken and be split apart, because everybody has their own will inside. And exterior nations outside the Imperium or Empire, they take advantage of this, of course. So this is the Empire, and we have Austria as the Emperor. That's of the reddish color there. The brownish color within the Empire, that's the voters. The others, they are not allowed to vote, but they are members. And in the beginning here, I'm sure they will lose the Italian part of the Empire right away. That's a big hit to them. And another nail in their coffin will be the uprising of Protestantism in the Reformation era. Reformation century in the 1500s, 16th century. So there are a lot of shit going on against them that will weaken them. Anything else we need to mention? We have a lot of trade we need to take care of. I think the traders, they are in a good spot everywhere. Yeah, they are doing fine here. We're sending trade from Krakow up to the Baltic Sea, which is our home node here, Baltic Sea, with that symbol above. You don't need traders there, merchants there. They're called merchants, not traders. And we have one merchant in Novgorod trying to send money from the Russian area into the Baltic Sea. And here you can see the power, where we are, how powerful we are in that node. We're only second in our home node as well. Teutonic Order is the strongest one. And that is the remnant of the Crusader King's holy orders. They got their own lands. So we have the Livonian orders here. Livonian order here. That's one order. And the Teutonic Order. They are usually being destroyed very early in the game. This era is not fit for them. They cannot get married and stuff like that, so they have a big disadvantages going on. Culture. Swedish, we have the Samis up here, Finnish, Karelians, Norwegians, Danish, Polish. Yeah. A lot of cultures. The Russians, they are... Russia is not even Russia. It's... Muscovy, Novgorod, Perm, Kazan. Yeah, this is the time when they start to grow. And in the end of the era, they have grown the Russia we see today. Yeah, about the same size. It goes fast. but if we can hinder that in this campaign, that would be great. I'm aiming for a relation with Poland, Lithuania here. To have a good friendship with them and France. France will unify them here as well. That's what they're gonna do. So I think we can strangle the forts here. I don't want to pay for my forts in the beginning. We can also withdraw them. And I'm not super used to this game, so you will see me make mistakes and stuff like that. But the channel is all about that, as you know. It's about casual Paradox gaming that... yeah, anyone can play it. And the main focus that one of my viewers mentioned in Hearts of Iron is that he thought I explained the progress very good compared to many others, and that's also very important in this game. That's why playing this with not explaining very intense is pointless, because you will not follow. Only professional players will follow them. What's going on? So let's see here. We have low crown land. So these are the estates. We have the clergy estate, nobility, and burghers. Not a peasants, of course, but they are not in power, so they are not mentioned here. When they are angry, they will just attack you. but it's a very discriminated group in this era. So I can seize land here. That is possible, and summon the Diet to get missions from the different estates, or sale titles. That's the opposite of seize. But I will get money, loyalty from them, but they will get more land, more influence, and could become dangerous if they get more powerful and disloyal in the future. That's not very good. So I want to seize land for the crown, and you can see the chart here to the left. 26% of the entire Swedish land. Finland is also Swedish, by the way. 26% of the entire Swedish land is owned by the crown. We have 17.5% owned by the burghers, 11.5% by the clergy, and the nobility owns 45%. They own the most land. So they are a problem for Sweden in history as well. The kings fought the nobles quite a lot. So we're going to seize this land right away, increase it to 31%. So we mostly stole from the nobles there. We will not be able to afford advisors in the beginning. I'm earning like 1.46. We also have ships. We have transport ships, and I do need it. The galleys I don't really care about. Yeah, I do not care about the galleys, so get rid of that. Let's see here. Yeah, here it is. Take away the galley. Erase it. And we will keep the four transports. I guess that will be enough, maybe. And we will build lightships for trade. That is what we are gonna do. So what else? What do we have here? Archking Christopher III von Wittelsbach. That's the Danish king, because we don't have a king of our own. We start in a personal union under Denmark here. So our main goal in the beginning is to break free. He's a 3-2-2. 6 points is the highest you can have in one of these: administration, diplomacy, and military. So he's less than mediocre as king, infertile as well. That's always good for us. We can open up all of these here, so we can. How many? Three diplomats. We have three diplomats, one missionary. Those are priests. Colonists zero, two merchants, and they are out on missions already. So I want to send an insult to Denmark right away, because we don't want to be in their union. Denmark also have Norway in that same union, so if we're going against Denmark, Norway will try to kick our ass as well. So we cannot just attack right now. We need to have friends, we need to have a bigger army. Yeah, anything else? He's 28 years old, that Danish king. Yeah, we have diplomatic reputation plus one. I don't think there's anything else. Level 3 in all of these. This is where you follow up in time to get into the Renaissance and then the colonial era. Missions we can accomplish. I will not probably read those. I will just get the missions done when they are done. I will play as I see fit. I will not follow the missions. That does not interest me, really. Because that's a thing you can calculate as well and stuff, and I don't have the patience for that. I just barely get the time to play these games. I cannot sit beside when I'm playing right now and study the game. I don't have time for that. Let's see. We can start with speed 3 and see where the alliances are being formed. speed 4 maybe. Lithuania Novgorod alliance. Okay, that was interesting. Denmark enter Sliga. Okay. Oh, yeah. Mini alliances. I want Poland as an ally if I can get it. So we can also check here which one wants to support our independence too. So far it's Lithuania and Scotland. Yeah, Lithuania will be useful. They will probably go into a union with Poland. That's what I'm waiting for. I know that is going to happen. Austria entered Baden, Denmark, Brandenburg. Let's improve relations with Poland. Improve relation with France, maybe. Fabricate claims in Novgorod. And we will be very opportunistic here when to attack the Danish and break free. Yeah, there we go. So, marriage in our arch queen. Okay. Trade embargo between Moscow and Novgorod, and the empire now looks like this. Ah, they will lose Italy if they do not complete one sort of mission. I think it is. Yes, and we have this striped area here as well. Those are imperial land, but owned by another country that is not a member. Which is also a problem for the Empire. Denmark allies with the Teutonic Order. Gotland is a pirate haven. Which is kind of annoying. Let's see if we can get these ships to trade in the Baltic. The other transports, they can go to Kalmar. Now there was a succession. That means they are in a... Or does it? No, it does not. Let's see what happens here. Support independence, Lithuania only. We don't need to improve relation with France. I take that diplomat back to form. They have quite a big army, actually. Lithuania. We could form an ask for independence thing with them then. Do that. We succeeded with a mission doing so. Swedish allies, okay. Supporters of Swedish independence. The Kalmar Union was supposed to represent the united will of Denmark, Norway and Sweden and be the protector of their common interests. In reality, however, it's only served as an expanded source of wealth and manpower for the Danes, allowing the Danish king the audacity to wage wars with the Hansa and cause troubles with the realms of Eastern Europe. The Danes made many enemies, and a majority of them would be more than happy to support us in our cause for independence. However, it would be more glorious for our kingdom managed to win the inevitable independence war on its own. And that would bring us the respect for other monarchies of Europe. So we need every supporter we can find, though. Yes, we do. Because I'm a diplomatic player. The Danes are no threat. We can win this by our own wars. Yeah, it's... we need every rival or enemy of Denmark will support us. Yeah, so that's pretty good. So the rival of Denmark is Lithuania, Bohemia and Scotland. So we actually have Bohemia with us automatically now. And Scotland. That's interesting. So we have three nations with us already. But I will wait. I need an event later on that will support independence and stuff as well. Air, another air. Okay. Sweden is going to get glorious. Trust me. Peasant rebellion in Novgorod. Right. The Arch Queen is pretty good. Oh, what the fuck happened? Swedish pretender rebels have risen up in Stockholm. These rebels are loyal for Sigvard Bagge, okay? That's pretenders to the throne. The thing is, it could be pretty good to let them win, but no. I want the independence war because I can steal land from the enemy while I win the independence war. But if I let these guys win in the rebellion here, Sweden will be liberated from Denmark, actually. That will be the case. Yeah, they're not taking our forts though, that's good. But they have a lot of troops. I think the Danes will help us. So we need to form up army maintenance like this. And move back to Åbo. And we hope for the Danish help. They have a lot of troops here. I don't know. I don't know if I should wait or not here. I think we need to fire up our forts, at least down here. That's a lot of troops. They have 28,000 men. I have 12,000 men. The Danes have 14,000 plus some 3,000 vassals, I think. So we will see if they are interested or we let them win and see what happens. Yeah, this could go fast. They have taken the capital, so. So I will actually loosen up these forts. Let them take it. It could be a very fast liberation for us. Danes are not trying to trying to stop us. They also have the 8,000 Norwegian army. Behead a few. What is this? Local nobles protesting. Okay. No, behead. Our prestige is minus 12, so it's not very good. Legitimacy is good because of the Danes. Liberty desire is 100, that's max, and that's good because we want to be free. Oh, the Danes are here now. They are trying to liberate, and they're being attacked by the... And I'm not going to help them, actually. The Danes are losing. This is pretty interesting. It is pretty interesting. To declare war here, they have Lithuania on their side. I don't like that. How will Muscovy deal? Muscovy needs the Novgorodian land in the beginning. How will they deal with Lithuania as an enemy right away? I haven't seen that before. That's pretty cool. This is what I mean with the sandbox part. It's so different. Every game is so different. So the good thing here, if the Danes are attacking these noble, these pretender rebels, they will lose troops, manpower, I will lose nothing. I'm actually going to save money. Army maintain. Why the fuck am I supporting the forts here again? I don't. Ah, the Danes went to war. We need to stop that that automatic thing with the forts. So activate all forts, automatically raise. No, there we go. How is the liberation process going? Ooh, 50%. Oh, the pretenders are attacking the Norwegian army. And as you can see in their look here, we're still in the Dark Ages. So as soon we need to level up here in the institution called, we are here, feudalism. This is the Dark Ages. You need to go to Renaissance. The Renaissance haven't even started yet. So we are absolutely still in the Crusader Kings era, late medieval times. Oh my god. Will they catch them? They're hunting 3,000 Danes and they catch them. And they stack wipe the entire Danish army. Wow. That's good for me. I want the Danes to get hurt. And when the pretender rebels win, I will get their king. Their armies will disappear. I don't need to fight them. Here's another 1,000 Danes that will be annihilated. There we go. Stack wiped. The Danes are using their Holstein vassal near Germany. And they are being attacked by the pretend rebels. Why do I say noble rebels? Pretender rebels, they are always... Their aim is always to place somebody else on the throne. They will change the rule of the entire court. And in this case, they are the perfect rebels for me. You even see they have the symbol of a throne there, so... they're attacking 3,000 Norwegians. It's very cool that... Yeah, install Sigvard Bagge the First. He has a strong claim, 95. But I don't see his skill points. I want to know how good he is. So now we're 64. They can soon just claim Sweden. Or take it. The entire Norwegian army is almost destroyed. They have 2,000 men or so. Here comes another 2,000 Danes as well. I think. Wow. They don't stand a fucking chance against these rebels. But I am enjoying this. We are fighting Taking the Conquest of Sligo. These are the... Sligo are in a war, and they have called Denmark. So Denmark is also in a war on the side with Sligo. Where is Sligo? I want to know what that is. Okay, Ireland. It's an Ireland, Irish state. Austria aligned with Naples. That's southern Italy. Mm-mm-mm. Things are playing out. So interesting. I have never liberated in this way before. It just hit me that, what the fuck, I can use the pretend rebels. But yes, it is a penalty, because when you're winning independence wars, you can take the entirety of Scania and stuff like that. I will not be able to do that, but I will be free much faster. So it's both pros and cons with this. They've taken almost everything of Sweden now. And the Danes know that I'm letting them, cutting off every defense in the forts. I don't have any armies in the forts, nothing. We have abandoned our forts. Oh my god. We are up in 88.7%. And I also think I will keep Bohemia and Lithuania as allies after. When I am... Yeah, this war, War of the Roses in England. what is this? Has tragically died. He died as well? Or he died because they took over? Yeah, they killed him. Yes. So it's over. All right. They killed the queen as well. Holy shit. So now Sigvard Bagge the First has taken over Sweden. He's not very good. 1-2-2. He has a strong claim though, so we have legitimacy 95 in the beginning. That's good. Current heir, Christian will die. Yeah. We can activate the merchant move now. So now we're independent. Very early in the game. But I hope this will pay off. Engelbrecht Rebellion. Yeah, it's not the Engelbrecht Rebellion. This was something else. But let's fire that up. We succeeded. You can read it yourself if you want to pause the game and read the text and stuff like that. I will not do it in my Let's Plays. It takes too long. It needs to be a certain flow here. And still interesting to watch. Gain 10,000 manpower. We have a maximum of 15,000. Now we have 24,000. And I think it will stay there. You will get it. So when an event like that comes, you will get the manpower. And it will not decay either. It will stay there. You can move back to Stockholm. We are completely... He's calm. Stability cost modifier minus 10%. That's always good. We could aim for a stability boost. Reduce war exhaustion, boost stability. So we have plus one stability, that's good for the taxes. Here you can see the modifiers for stability right now. We need to fabricate claims on Denmark. Okay, we have maxed out our relation with Poland. Have they forced Lithuania into a union yet? Or will they? No, they're only allied with them, so I would like to have an alliance with Poland. It's very close that they want to do this. It could be a thing, but a good thing to think about here is to ally with their allies and hate the same nations they hate. That's a very good strategy. So, Poland, they do not like Austria and Teutonic Order. I should not like Teutonic Order either, because Denmark likes them. Hungary is a rival to Poland as well. So, I need to select rivals. Here, I don't have any rivals. I will select three of them. I'm at war. I'm not at war. I'm not in a union. What are they talking about? Oh, so I'm in that war still. I need to get out of there. I don't care about this Irish shit going on over there. Seriously? Yeah, they're winning the wars though, so let's just wait then. Now we're earning double the amount of money. That is always good. We don't have the capacity to train because we don't have the money. Now we're not... Yeah, we're earning 3. We can activate that when we are at war. Get more taxes. We will get that now. Yeah, so 3.43 instead, thanks to the war taxes. So people pay more taxes when we are at war. They do that... I don't know if it's willingly, or... I don't think so. We don't have any cardinals. So this is completely random when you get cardinals, but the more cardinals, the stronger you will be in the Vatican and in the Catholic faith altogether. The religion in this area is very powerful. Not as powerful as in Crusader Kings, but it's still very powerful. But this is the game where the religious powers will start to fade as time goes by. What is this? Noble to make our king flirt with somebody. We will lose... I don't think that's good. She was not that very good, and she will lower the legitimacy a lot. We are earning our money, at least. Waiting for the wars to end. They are medium now, so... So, yeah, Irish conflicts we need to be we need to be a part of right now. New monarch in Novgorod. Are they still protected by Lithuania? They are. So that means Lithuania is still free. This might be one of those campaigns where Lithuania is not a personal union partner of Poland. That could be very interesting. And they are protecting Novgorod, which is also so interesting. But it means that I cannot go against Novgorod. I will not have that power. Maybe if I get Bohemia with me. But I don't think so. Lithuania is pretty strong. The tech levels are about the same as well. The burghers request privileges. Fifth administration. We need to side with nobility or burghers. We see here estate loyalty. Yeah, let's stay with the burghers this time. Otherwise, we would have got some too angry burghers there. The nobility could handle that, but it will not go below 30% and it will be angry. So that was a good balance. So I want to rival people, and I cannot do that while at war. It's also very good to increase our army size. And Sweden, they are very good when it comes to... Let's see where it says here. Here. So these are the Swedish ideas. And this is Swedish... This is unique for Sweden. We get mercenary maintenance boost, infantry combat ability, plus 20% just for being Sweden. Sweden are awesome with infantry. Cavalry works, but get more infantry as Sweden. Land leader shock. So that's a leader bonus. So, yeah. Let's see here. We do have 9 regiments of infantry and 3 regiments of cavalry. Artillery has not come... Yeah, it comes later in the game. Just boost infantry. They cost 10 gold or ducats each. That will not work. We have maxed out, so we cannot do anything. Why does it say that we have 19 troops when it says 12 here? Did we get troops or what the fuck is going on? The Finnish army, what? Ah! We got an army up here with pure infantry, that's fucking great. Let's get them down to Stockholm then. That means we have our army, so yeah. You might think like this, that let's keep a low army. We're not going to fight for a while, so let's not have as many troops because it's cheaper. But it also affects alliances. Other nations will see you as weak and they don't want to be your friend. So you need to present a large, impressive army for other kingdoms and empires to be able to do that. I wonder how long this... These are Danish stupid conflicts we need to deal with. Maybe we should attack the Danes right away. What do they have? I don't have any casus bellis on them, so that would suck. No. We would be crushed if we do that. So we can fabricate claims on Novgorod here to begin with. We need 20 points with Denmark to start fabricating as well. So Bohemia is my... No, they are not my friend. Interesting. Alliance is going... No. Getting less likely to become ally with Poland. We need to befriend their friends. Kili? What the fuck? Yeah, that's why we need to rival Teutonic Order and then Poland would be my friend. I think so. So what is going on here? Is anybody fighting? I don't think so. So Sligo is fighting Tyrconnell, so that, yeah. Now it seems like the enemy is winning. Let's see here. Yeah. All right. I want to see if I can leave. That do not seem possible. An alliance with the Livonian Order. No, they are friends with Teutonic Order. That's not gonna happen, sorry. We can fabricate claims on Denmark. Blekinge, there we go. Maybe a threatened war? I don't think that will work, but... Now we can't do that while at war. There are a lot of things you cannot do while at war. But this will mark the end of the first episode, so... Let's get those wars out of the way so we can focus on alliances and rivaling. Take care, and I hope you will enjoy this journey. I will see you next time. Bye.